All right, so Janice, you should be able to see the live now if you refresh your screen.
And you'll see your photos down in the corner there.
Okay, so I click on the live thing. And I can see Stacy and Brianne. Yeah, and a picture of myself.
Are we delayed?
Are we delayed?
Yeah.
Oh, I was like, what?
It takes a minute. We already got four people. Let's go a little quicker.
Oh, hi. Hi, everybody.
Hey, everybody.
Yeah, you're really delayed.
So as we get started, Janice, then just listen to the where we're talking instead of the video, since the video is a little bit behind.
Yeah,
we'll get everybody online confused even more than we're already confused here.
Okay, so I'll respond to what I hear rather than what I see.
Yes, that would be a good choice.
Okay.
But you can still take note of the comments, because I know you like to look at them and ponder them.
Right. So there will be a chat window. So I'll respond to what I hear rather than what I see.
Yeah.
I see Howard is joined us. Hello, Howard. Whoever else is joining us, for the sake of Bernice and I, let us know you're here, if you could. We're going to get started very soon, just giving it a couple of minutes and letting people join in as they want to. So we've got some people joining us. It's 7:01. Should we start rolling at 7:02? You think, or how long should we wait for people to
Yeah, let's give it a couple more minutes, let everybody, because they're starting to get the notifications that we started, so, yeah.
Okay.
Give it another two.
I feel like maybe we should be doing something interesting for the people who are joining us.
Do you have any hidden talents that they should
have? No, I have none. I don't even have a hobby, really. But, oh, you know what, we did. I saw one of our staff people posted a great April Fool's thing today.
I saw that too.
Where, you know, we train service dogs here, and she put up that we one of the goats from one of the other employees was visiting to do socialization with the service dogs, and she posted a picture of the goat and said, "We're now training service goats." And then she said, "No, April Fool's," which is great. I think that's funny. It made me laugh. Makes me think maybe we should.
I don't think it's legal.
It isn't. No, the access, there would be lots of issues with access. So, but I would enjoy it. I would hold the baby goats. That would give me an opportunity to hold baby goats.
Therapy goats, maybe.
We can do therapy goats. Yeah. But then the chickens are going to want a piece of action. So I'm just throwing that all out there.
So I see Kathy Hansen and Braylon White have joined too. If you're here, say hello.
Krista's on as well. Hi, Krista. I just don't want everybody to miss the video in the beginning.
I know.
You know?
Well, I mean, we can replay it, I suppose, if we end up with people. I'm trying to figure out where we're coming from. We can replay the video then,
sure.
Too, right?
Yeah, we can do that.
Okay.
We should be able to rewind it.
Good.
All right, so let's get started. I'll pull the video up, and then
okay,
if
you
want
so,
to talk about it.
Yeah, so everybody, thank you very much for tuning in tonight. The purpose of this discussion is to answer questions in real time of the things we've been talking about the PetSmart Charities presentation that we're having some trouble with understanding. Hopefully you have taken the time to look at the video that we made and also the blog that we posted. And if you've gone to look at the presentation yourself as well, we want to just have just real conversation, dialogue about what it is that's bothering us so much about this presentation and the things that are wrong with it. So we're going to start this conversation by playing a clip from the actual presentation. We want you to hear the words in this clip coming from the person who expressed them in the presentation, the chief analytical officer, or no, the chief of analytics for PetSmart Charities. His name is Roger Haston. I think I'm pronouncing that correctly. These are his words, and it's important for us, for you to hear them, because it explains a little bit about where we're coming from. So can we go ahead and start that?
We have to get honest about risk assessment. I mean, for me, it's very fascinating. We deal with these just intense life and death decisions on a day-to-day basis. It's really amazing. We have almost no formal risk methodology at all. You can look at other industries that have really moved a long ways down the risk assessment and risk management process. We have barely even started, and I use the analogy that right now our risk assessment is kind of the equivalent of loading up, testing airplane safety by loading up airplanes full of people and sending them off, and then concluding that they must be safe because nobody came back to tell you they crashed. And I know that's a little extreme, but that is essentially what we're doing. We have to become more realistic and better at understanding and managing risk.
Stick with this,
both for people and pets. And then, as I mentioned, we suffer from a lack of diversity. Incredible. And I've been studying a lot on diversity and all that. And I would say you go from ignorant to terrified as you start to see just a little window of what you didn't see before, because it highlights how little you probably actually do see. We, as an industry, are basically a bunch of white guys like me at the top, a bunch of white women everywhere else, and that's kind of it. And we're very affluent middle class for that purpose. And I think what's really concerning to me is that we need to start to serve these underserved neighborhoods, yet we don't look like them at all. And this is a problem that is endemic in our society. And we really need to take it on. And I think the scary thing is we're going to totally screw it up. And it's not simply about taking a brown person and putting them into the system. That's doomed to fail. It's about changing the system so that it starts to truly become a fair and equitable system that starts to attract and look like the people that we're actually trying to serve. And I think the big thing that we have, this is the part of it that I think is really exciting to me, is we have a currency that no other industry or government has, and that is animals. Animals bring people together like.
Okay, so we thought it was important to start with playing that clip because there's a lot of incorrect information in the presentation, and we can go through that and answer questions as they come up in the coming weeks, days, months, or however long it takes. We're going to keep at this until we actually get some answers from PetSmart Charities. So we'll get to the point by point of the mistakes that are made in the presentation and why they should be corrected and what's dangerous about it. But we really needed to start with that clip because we needed to address the comment that was made about the people that we need to help in animal welfare. We are not okay. We are not okay with divvying up neighborhoods or the people who care about animals, or the people who want to take care of their animals based on somebody's description of what they look like. I'm avoiding even saying the term brown people as he did, because it makes me so uncomfortable. But it was important for us to play that clip for you, because for us, we can't unhear that. So to be fair, we now view the rest of his presentation and the information that he has presented, or I should say PetSmart Charities. I don't want to single out Roger Haston so much, because this is PetSmart Charities. This isn't just Roger Haston. It's branded as PetSmart Charities. So whatever PetSmart Charities then says, we see through that lens of labeling and discrimination, the calling out of socioeconomic status based on neighborhood and willingness to take care of their pets and how they can take care of their pets. it has caused us to have perhaps a different view of what we had of his presentation up until that point. Because in fairness, that comes towards the end of his presentation. It's not at the very beginning. So each time we go through and watch the presentation, more of it connects to for us about what it is that, that PetSmart Charities is really saying about the people who care about their pets. We do not, absolutely do not think it's okay to say that white people help brown people take care of their pets. That is, it's offensive. And also there's the statement of that it's the white people in animal welfare that are affluent and therefore it shows just an utter disconnect to what happens in sheltering and the so many wonderful programs that are actually helping pet owners provide the care they wish to for their pets. Okay. All that being said, we're going to let that part go, although answer any questions anybody has about or take comments. If you guys want to weigh in on that, go right ahead. Absolutely. This we want this to be really sort of an open discussion and dialogue, but we felt it was important to put that out there to start with. Okay. So also joining us, I'm Stacey Coleman, by the way. I'm the executive director of Animal Farm Foundation. We jumped right in there. We didn't even introduce ourselves. I apologize. This is
Bernice Clifford, and I'm the director of behavior and training at Animal Farm.
And running the technology is Nikki.
Hi.
Nikki's the foundation manager, she's helping us get this technology working. And you'll see in the corner of your screen is the lovely Janice Bradley. Janice is joining us on the phone, so you will be able to hear Janice, but you will only see her photo. She won't move. It's a wonderful trick she does. Say hi, Janice.
Yes, you'll be able to hear me speak, but I should probably be using these talents to be a ventriloquist. She'll notice no movement of my face.
Well, I'm really glad you're joining us. So Janice is the director of communications and publications for National Canine Research Council. Many years ago when we started at Animal Farm Foundation, we realized there was a real gap in fact-based, evidence-based, truly reliable research that informed how we live with our dogs, as we have done for so long in such successful ways. That we acquired National Canine Research Council and turned Janice and her gang loose to really raise the bar on the standard of research that we use to inform how we live with the dogs that share our lives and our homes. So Janice, thank you for joining us. At the beginning of that clip, there was we heard PetSmart Charities talk about risk assessment, and that's what Janice is going to bring to this conversation. But I we'll get to that point, Janice, and really just jump in, because whenever you have something to add to this conversation, we've all spent a lot of time looking at this presentation, trying to understand where PetSmart Charities is coming from. It seems like a brand new direction, as I said in the other video that we made, that PetSmart Charities has this really great history of helping all dogs, regardless of breed label. Like, I remember when that happened many years ago, when PetSmart Charities signed on to help Best Friends Animal Society start a program. Remember, because they all met here. We hosted a summit for this, and it was this great coming together of organizations. Best Friends Animal Society was doing a particular community outreach, and PetSmart Charities was helping to fund it, and they all came here to do some training and to make a game plan and move forward, and these organizations were working together. And somehow, somewhere, something terrible changed. And the animals are now, and more specifically the pit bull dogs, I think, are taking the brunt of it. Because to be quite honest, what this whole presentation and direction for PetSmart Charities or Roger Haston seems to be basically an attack on no-kill or best friends. And if anybody's new to the phrase no-kill is a description of a sheltering ideology, so a philosophy towards sheltering, which is you get creative and you do the best you can to make sure that all of the animals in your care get placed, with the exception of those who are irredeemably suffering or irredeemably unsafe. And I'm not exactly sure when PetSmart Charities changed their mind and decided they didn't like no-kill and didn't like best friends, but that seems to be where we are right now. Bernice, what do you think about that?
What do I think about them?
Well, listen, you guys know, you know me. I will talk about this because it's so, you guys have been so tolerant with me. I've been so aggravated by this ever since I've seen the presentation, and I've been trying to communicate with PetSmart Charities for 2 months now. It started out with Janice, you were on that call. So we had a director of ours saw the presentation in New York City, contacted us, said, I'm a little uneasy about the language. It feels like perhaps we're moving backwards. We found a copy of the presentation online that was recorded in San Diego, and we were concerned about it. So Janice, myself, and a couple of other people were on a call with Roger Haston to talk about this. And the call was not particularly productive. He did offer to consider resources. We sent him resources. We made that letter available publicly online for what we sent him. And the response to that was, thank you for your opinion. You are clearly very passionate. Good day. And that was that. There was no more interest in hearing any of our information. So I tried talking to the PetSmart Charities CEO, Deb Turcotte. She responded quickly and said, I'll look into this. And then I haven't really heard anything else except to say I didn't get to it as quickly as I had hoped, but I'm still trying. And so we thought, you know what, we're not gonna stay silent about this anymore, because from what appears to be a feud between either Roger Haston and PetSmart Charities and the idea of no-kill or Best Friends Animal Society, maybe even specifically, is now causing issues for the dogs and taking us backwards, and we're not going to do it. So, Janice, Bernice, Nikki, weigh in. Talk to us about your perception of the presentation and what you saw.
Is it possible, Stacy, to look at the slide that we started with again, the one about the slide about risk, or is that?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. Just give me a minute.
We're getting there.
Because I think that was at the first root of our concern, and much of the substance of the first conversation with Roger Haston was the repetition in the presentation that there's some sort of unacknowledged danger or risk connected to dogs living in shelters. And we were very much puzzled by this, but it was repeated throughout the presentation, even though it's quite clear that there's simply no evidence at all that is the case. In fact, there's quite strong evidence that that's not the case. That there's no reason to perceive dogs living in shelters as anything other than that. They're just dogs who, at a particular point in their lives, usually through some sort of bad luck, I suppose, find themselves living in a shelter. This was the slide that brought up those things. So these claims that there's no formal risk assessment methodology, by which I assume is meant that there's no formal sort of good housekeeping seal for dogs that go through shelters to promise that they will never injure anyone. And this is true. There have actually been attempts to put together instruments like this, but we know now that they're unreliable and can't pass basic validity issues. But, and this really addresses the second point here, to a very great extent, it doesn't matter. In other words, people in the normal day-to-day life of a shelter can quite routinely assess and observe the behavior of the dogs in their care in as real world a situation as happens in the day-to-day life of the shelter, and tell whether or not those dogs actually present a danger to human beings. It's not something that requires a scientific assessment. This idea that the public safety issues are sparse and often flawed is a bit misleading, because what we do know, we do have that the CDC maintains a record of injuries from all important causes that occur to people that send them to an emergency department to seek some kind of medical attention. Mm-hmm. And often these are very minor, but the person considered it enough of an injury to go to an emergency department. And one of the things that's tracked through this system and has been tracked in the same way for almost 20 years now, in a very meticulous way, from a very large sample from emergency departments all over the country. And what we see when we look at dog bite incidents over this 20-year period is no change.
Okay, so
it's remained the same for 20 years.
Right.
If we had this population explosion of dogs in shelters that for some reason we used to kill, but we don't kill them anymore, we would expect to see at least an uptick in that incident. It has not happened.
Right. And I think that is such an essential point to the discussion that we're having here about this presentation, because you're correct. The whole point of this was that the quality of the dogs in our shelters is declining, and it is therefore a public safety risk, therefore we should be euthanizing. Is that, we talked about this today, yes. Denise, is that, what did yes. you perceive of that?
I mean, I had a hard time understanding what he was saying, because he kept pairing things like aggressive and pit bull came up often together, which was a concern for me, because he didn't have, there wasn't evidence of a particular dog doing something. Like at one point he made a comment that shelter messaging is confusing, because one day you could go in and adopt a lovely puppy, and the next day you could go in and adopt an aggressive pit bull. And so it was sort of like, are you saying that pit bulls in the shelter are aggressive, or are you saying if you're not a puppy? Like it was super confusing.
It is. And
the fact that he was saying 40% of the animals in shelters are unwanted was...
And unwanted pit bulls, too, I think. So one of the things that we noticed as we were drawing attention to this over the last few days is that people would say, you know, but he's made a point or something in the site, but he has a point on this particular topic or whatever. And that's why we showed you or played for you the clip at the very beginning about how PetSmart Charities is now segregating and making assumptions about human population, because I think it's telling that perhaps that's how they're doing it for dogs, because if we can't look at humans and value them as individuals, how can we possibly look at dogs and value them as individuals? So we've been very puzzled by that. I've asked for clarification from PetSmart Charities and haven't gotten it yet. Just as we were all discussing ahead of this as we were preparing, we're never really sure if Roger Haston and PetSmart Charities is talking about animal sheltering, pet ownership, public safety, or social services. It all seems to kind of conflate. So for me, it's not particularly clear. And there are a couple of points in particular that that caused me the most concern with this is in the presentation, he talks about dog bite related fatalities. I don't think he refers to him in that way, but he shows a picture of a person. And Janice, this is where you're going to really be able to help us on this as well. He shows us a picture of a woman who very tragically was killed by several dogs. And I think this happened in, I can't remember exactly where it happened, Philadelphia or Baltimore, somewhere. And in his presentation, he says very clearly, this woman was killed by a pack of pit bulls. But we looked at it and found that the dogs, they caught a group of dogs that they thought were involved. They euthanized those dogs, but forensic testing proved that none of those dogs were involved. And there were no witnesses to the tragedy, but that didn't stop PetSmart Charities from saying that it was the pit bulls that killed the dogs. So let's look at the, I don't know, I was going to use some animal metaphor, like the elephant in the room, but it seems to be that they're targeting the pit bull dogs now. And Janice, I think you might be able to help a little bit more to explain like the forensics that explain how they tested the dogs that were they thought were involved with this person, because I know you've done some research in dog bite related fatalities. What can you tell us about that?
Probably I don't have that case report, but since they had a group of dogs that they thought had been involved in this fatality, they could do DNA testing. So which ruled out these particular dogs. So the dogs involved in this incident were never identified.
Right. So,
but even if they had, it would be extremely difficult to. It would be extremely unlikely that they would have been able to subsequently identify them as members of any particular breed anyway, even if they had gotten the right dogs, which they didn't. But the most troubling thing about that to me was that in the presentation, this is used to make a point about kind of particular dangerous dogs and this idea that people aren't paying enough attention to how dangerous dogs and pit bulls are in particular, without even fact checking the example that was being used. That was probably the most troubling part of that to me.
Right. And it's probably important to add too that the instances of dog bite, just as the instances of dog bites don't change, dog bite related fatality instances vary very little. That the particular instances that it just stays about the same every year, doesn't it?
Yes, and it's they're very, very, very rare, which in turn makes it difficult to generalize about them, and probably difficult to actually create any change. When something happens extremely rarely, it's very, very difficult to change, because it's probably the result of a variety of things coming together all at the same time that's very, very rare.
Right. So, and Bernice had something to add.
Yes, I was just going to say that slide, I was completely confused as to what it had to do with animal welfare and the future of animal welfare, since from what I recall reading, I don't recall that many of those dogs came from shelters. So what does that have to do with sheltering and shelter dogs?
Yeah, it has nothing to do with sheltering and shelter dogs. The answer, as I recall, Stacy, from our phone call, was that Roger Hastings said that he felt that his mission went beyond sheltering. And I didn't quite understand what that meant in the context of this material about dog bite related fatalities.
Yeah.
So I'm at a loss about that.
Right. Well, there's
never able to clarify what he meant by that.
We were given one clue, and that was in the initial email that he sent to our director, and that was that he would only start taking Animal Farm Foundation seriously if we funded research for dogsbite.org. So that's kind of a clue, I think, to where he was coming from. Now, since there hasn't been any further communication on that, I will have to say it's only speculation that that's what is his motivation, but I can say quite clearly and confirm that he suggested we fund research with dogsbite.org, which I suspect is where he got the graphic and the list of people that he uses in his presentation. Let's move towards some other. Do we have questions yet? I feel like we just keep talking. We're not interacting with our people who are joining us.
They're being very interactive. Just really agreeing with everything that we're putting out there. The only one question we had was, what's the financial motivation behind PetSmart Charities villainizing dogs? Is there financial motivation for villainizing the dog that lives in shelters? Why would they be?
It is a mystery to us. We are unsure why, and that was one of the questions that we posed to PetSmart Charities. And again, this is not, I want everybody to know, we have tried and tried and tried and tried to communicate with PetSmart Charities before talking about this publicly. But we weren't getting a lot of response, and we certainly weren't getting cooperation or willingness to listen. We were dismissed as being passionate and having opinions. We don't know what the motivation would be. We cannot possibly think of what the motivation would be. We only know that since we've started talking about this, we've heard from a lot of people, and I will only say this briefly because I don't want to speak in any kind of vagary, but we've heard from a lot of people who have had experience with this particular speaker who have relayed stories to me privately about his opposition to no-kill sheltering. So I think that's the motivation. I really do believe that's the motivation. But to answer to your question, I don't think there's any financial gain to it. I think it's only agenda-based. Is that fair? That's a speculation. And maybe that's not a fair thing to say, but that's what I've put together from this.
Did he say something about the shelter should be making money, or could there be financial gain in that sense? I'm trying to remember.
Well, I that's a really great question because so much of that was convoluted. And we watched the presentation again today trying to understand all of this. But there's something about the, they feel like the supply chain will be damaged if the shelters don't have the dogs that people want. And nobody wants pit bull dogs. And probably chihuahuas, I think, were in there too, right? If I remember correctly, I think do we have that slide?
All of his data was from one shelter, though.
Oh, that's true. Can we put up that slide that's got the blue and columns?
Absolutely.
And the things? That's one. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they don't see it yet.
Okay. So what we're doing is we've added a slide that is part of the presentation. And it was Bernice who brought this up. She said, this is data from just one shelter. And I think it was San Diego.
I think it was
the San Diego shelter. But what the point of this is that if you're a poodle, right? If you're a poodle, you come in and go out.
If you're a toy poodle, no matter what, you come in and go out. But all of these other dogs, you see how many they say came into their shelter and then what they are able to place of those animals, which seems a bit ridiculous, but it's also only data from one shelter,
right?
And you don't know anything about policy or area, or you don't. There's no other information. This is not national data,
right? But it's presented as evidence that nobody wants
those dogs.
So let's talk about this. Let's talk about that breed label that he uses, because he has the term that PetSmart Charity uses in this called blocky-headed whatevers. And actually, we noticed today in the presentation that they're pretty proud of it, and Roger Hastings suggested that perhaps he trademark it. Okay. But what does that tell us? Now, Janice just did a podcast for us on this, right? Basically about the labels. So, Janice, walk us through this.
It's extremely difficult to unpack this because Because, A, we have no idea what's meant by pit bull or pit bull mix. There's no possible way of knowing what that means. In other words, was that a visual identification on the part of shelter staff? Most likely. And what we know about that is that people don't agree. So you've got some mishmash of dogs here that may or may not have something have something, you know, visually in common, morphologically is the fancy term for it. And then you say, okay, we have a whole bunch of these dogs because we think this group of dogs looks alike. And even though other people might not think that they resembled each other at all, and then we say, okay, you know, do they go out of the shelter? But even, I mean, that term outflow is completely confusing to me, because does that mean that all the dogs on the no outflow, you know, column, they killed all those dogs? I don't think so. If it was San Diego Humane, so what does that mean? Does it mean they had a slightly longer length of stay? I don't know. And then they got Chihuahua without anything that says Chihuahua mix, where a recent study has shown that visual identification of Chihuahuas is no more reliable than any other breed. So that was a bunch of little short-haired dogs of some kind. Now, right. You might be able to say that you're, you know, a lot of your population is short-haired dogs of X size, and the little ones you call Chihuahuas, and the big ones you call pit bulls, and then you track how many of those get adopted, how fast, but I'm not sure what you've demonstrated by that, except that maybe some adopters who use that shelter have some kind of size or coat length preferences in the dogs that they adopt.
Right.
But it isn't clear that any of them really didn't get adopted at all anyway, so the point is completely lost on me.
Right.
I don't know what it means. And
we
that was
either.
The feeling that I had in the majority of his presentation, which was, I don't really know what it means.
Or why. Right. So you make a really excellent point. So here's a question, and fairness, the presentation that we watched, the recording of, was in San Diego. Maybe we need to ask San Diego then if those are the animals.
I think he said this came from a Southern California shelter. I don't know that he said San Diego in this one.
Oh, I made the assumption
that this
because
came from San Diego.
Yeah, because San Diego's in Southern California.
Oh, yeah, I can't imagine.
Well,
I guess we could ask.
We do want to know what happened to the rest of those dogs. Where did those dogs go? Because that is begging the question of, if PetSmart Charities believes that 40% of the dogs in our shelters are not wanted, what do we do with those dogs? And the option would be what? What could we possibly be? What if nobody wants those dogs, what are we going to do with them, PetSmart Charities?
Right, but how did we determine that nobody wants them? Is
well,
it based on location? Is it based on what is that based on?
You
could only determine that if you had a shelter that euthanized based on length of stay.
Right. But is that what I guess it just
I didn't think that was what he meant.
It's hard to say. I don't know.
I have no idea.
I don't know. But if PetSmart Charities is coming out against no-kill because it creates dogs, they would say it's creating dogs that are unsafe for placement, and they're dogs nobody wants. The only other option is, I would say, disposing of those dogs, which would be euthanasia. And that's what we haven't been able to get an answer on, is what it is that they expect to happen to those dogs. Anybody have any idea? So Do we have the slide, the dogonomics? I think that's the one you were referring to before. So there was another question. This is showing the slide. It's pure selfishness for Bernice and I. Okay, let's be honest. When we saw this slide and heard what went along with the slide, we kind of laughed and thought, what the heck, we've been doing this wrong all these years. So PetSmart Charities is talking about how much money can be made off of dogs and their adoption fees. The claim was made that that the people in the neighborhoods that need assistance, that need our help, the ones that he was referencing at the beginning of the presentation, don't have their pets altered, don't have their pit bulls altered because they can sell their puppies for $1,000, $2,000, or $3,000 each.
So why would they wind up in shelters?
Precisely.
That's a very valuable commodity.
I was going to say, anyway, but we also, we looked at this shelter slide too here, and we've been to a fair number of shelters in our lifetime, I'd say. Mm-hmm. We know a little bit about what we're talking about, just a little bit, right?
A little bit.
Yeah. The cost of taking care of animals in shelters, especially doing it correctly, and especially in these big fancy shelters that are being built these days, the cost of care per day goes up regularly. And so the notion that adoption fees is a source of income for shelters is confusing to us. Janice, you got anything on that?
This was completely baffling to me because he talks about this as if people who are transporting dogs are making this, from some, shelter somewhere that can't adopt them out, is, transferring the dogs to a shelter where they can, and is making a huge profit on this. Mm-hmm. But this, which apparently leads to the mafia taking over the whole thing, as he claims has happened in Italy because there's so much money in it. This is also a good example of one of those misleading big numbers. He talks about $105 million in, nationwide in these profits, which sounds like a big number until you look at one of his other slides where he talks about the cost of keeping a dog in a shelter and looking at that as a shelter spending at least $1,000 per dog. Now, if you're selling them for $450 and you're spending $1,000 plus the acquisition costs on them, that doesn't sound like a great profit-making endeavor to me.
No. No. But I think it does sound like justification that if your shelter has dogs that you don't think anybody wants who are going to stay longer, it would be a good reason to euthanize them rather than spend the money on them. And I don't mean to be that pessimistic, but I kind of feel like that's where it's going, at least in the minds of PetSmart Charities, which is, again, baffling to me of why they feel that way. Do you have do we have questions to answer, or can we just keep yammering?
We had a few questions. One, I don't know if we're going to get into later, is, he calls the dogs blocky-headed, and, the difference between that and bully breed and terrier mix, and, what's wrong with that language. And also, do you think that PetSmart Charities knew that he was going to go this direction, and do you think that they're trying to fix it, which I think we sort of touched on in the beginning, but if you want to talk about it a little bit more.
Well, let's take that one first. So does PetSmart Charities know that that Roger Haston has adopted this language or this approach? I don't know. Our conversations with Roger Haston were not particularly productive. They were cordial, but they were not particularly productive. So not a lot of insight was to be had there. I can tell you that I today listened to an audio version. There was no video involved in it, but the audio version of somebody else giving the presentation, I believe to be David Hallworth, if I'm saying his name correctly, who was the previous CEO at PetSmart Charities and was abruptly dismissed a couple of months ago, I think, and nobody really knows why, at least I don't know why, but I wasn't looking for that information. When he gave the presentation, he did not implicate pit bull dogs in any sort of future tragedy whatsoever. Mm-hmm. In fact, he very vigorously said that labeling shelter dogs is not useful for lumping them together for any useful information. So I don't know. That wouldn't, again, I don't know because I didn't get response from PetSmart Charities corporate but that would make me believe that perhaps this is a lot of opinion coming from Roger Haston too, but I don't know for sure. But should we talk about the label thing?
Sure. I think Janice talked about that a lot in the podcast. With
right.
Why can't we just say fully breed or blocky headed, like he says in his presentation?
Right. So we hear statistics of percentages coming from shelters that say, you know, X percentage of our dogs are pit bulls. But Janice talked about this a little bit already, that if you say 40% of your dogs are pit bull, first of all, pit bull isn't a breed, so it's not really an actual breed grouping. It's just a descriptor used based on an opinion of appearance. But if you say 40% of your dogs are pit bull, that is a group that you have created with your label, not a legitimate group of genetically similar dogs. Janice, can you run through that again?
It can never be a meaningful term unless we had agreement on what we meant by it. That's what language is. So, I mean, a word or a phrase in language is something that people all agree means the same thing. There has never been such a definition of the term pit bull, and it's unlikely that there ever will be. There's one breed with pit bull in the name. There are a variety of other breeds with bull in the name. There are various legislative entities, you know, regulatory entities that define it as various breeds and mixes of breeds and dogs resembling those breeds, and other municipalities that define it in other ways. There simply is not now, nor has there ever been, a definition of what's meant by that. It means whatever the person talking at the moment thinks that it means. In other words, it's an empty term. It just isn't useful.
Right, and therefore any sort of other descriptor, like a blocky head, is not particularly useful. You said something today when we were watching this, Bernice, who doesn't get worked up about a lot, she put her phone down on the table, and she said, what's about the dogs from the cruelty cases?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we've helped out so many times with cruelty cases and bite busts, and those dogs don't have big blocky heads. The dog that he put in the picture was this beautiful, big-headed, I don't know, was not an American Pit Bull Terrier.
Not by breed standard.
And, you know, what we're used to seeing when we go to these things is these little black or little red dogs, like, you know, 35 pounds. If you get a 50-pound one, that's a big one.
But their heads certainly aren't
giant. They don't have all these cropped ears. It's rare that we would see them with cropped ears.
I don't know that in all the time we were taking.
There were a few in Ohio.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yet we're so, and it happens in, and I think, okay, I don't believe that that's the inspiration for PetSmart Charities to put a lighter spin on and kind of soften up what it is we're calling the dogs. And I know a lot of advocates probably do that as a way to sort of soften up the thinking of the dog, but it really doesn't do us any good. It's not helping the dogs. It's still an arbitrary label. Can we just stop using the label or any kind of a label? Just, they're mixed breed dogs that are coming into our shelters. That's what it is. And what happens when we still buy into the idea that you can group dogs together based on appearance without a pedigree, We're not talking at the dog show here, folks. We're talking at the animal shelters and in the general community. If you try to group dogs together based on appearance, you're creating nothing except an arbitrary group. You're not really learning anything meaningful about who those dogs are and how those dogs behave. And certainly not whether or not anybody wants them from a shelter. Our experience is when you take breed labels off, the dogs all go home.
Nice dogs all go home.
Nice dogs go home. So I spoke with two large open admission shelters this past week. I've been doing a lot of research on this. And we were talking about breed labels, and neither one of these shelters label their dogs anymore. And they both said the same thing Bernice just said, that as soon as they stopped putting labels on their dogs, all of their dogs started going home at the same rate. There was no more change in length of stay. The nice dogs go home. The nice dogs go home. So, Nikki, what are we hearing from everybody?
We have, what's with his idea that if all shelters are combined and run by one entity, that money would be saved and operations would be more efficient? It sounds like he likes the Italy model as long as it's not run by the mafia.
Well, I don't know. So there are, he had examples of like the PCA, and he had another example too of other places that have sort of combined approaches to taking care of the homeless animals in their countries or communities. There are a few examples of that here where there's been mergers within cities, and I think mm-hmm. sometimes that works. But I guess the biggest question we had when we were watching that, first of all, we have zero understanding of where the claim comes from that the Italian mafia is running the dog shelters in southern Italy. We have looked. Janice, any idea? Anything?
I have to confess, I haven't looked into that. It seemed I couldn't figure out any possible relevance to our situation, even if that were true. And it did kind of strike me as a wild sort of claim.
Right.
I mean, I just don't know.
But it's very useful. Making that claim is very useful for fear mongering. And if you if you have a message that is
used a loaded term, and he extended that idea to a couple of other countries where it really seemed strange.
Bosnia and Taiwan.
You know,
yeah.
Bosnia and Taiwan. As far as I know, there is no no-kill policy in Taiwan, and only till very recently, I believe, that dogs were major menu items there.
Yes.
So
yeah,
it's
until 2017.
To make
yeah.
that an analogous situation.
Yeah, and one of the things that occurred to, and this is, I mean, this sounds funny, and it's not really meant to be funny, but when Bernice and I were watching this today, we wondered, why do we assume that the Italian mafia isn't taking care of the animals?
Mm-hmm.
Do we know that? So even if they are running the shelter, is it because the Italian mafia? Is he saying the mafia is not good to animals? We have so many questions. We don't know. And you know what? We're laughing about this now, and we're having a little fun with this right now. But the fact of the matter is, this presentation was filled with fear-mongering. And the best we can tell, because we don't have any other information to tell us anything differently, it was an attempt to move the emotions of people in the audience towards believing what he wants to be true, which is no kill is going to be bad for shelters and bad for people.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't believe that for a minute, just for the record. That's not where we're going.
Mm-hmm.
I saw a slightly different, the first version of the slides I saw was slightly different and ended with an actual warning that we need to be careful or we'll undo all of the human-canine bond.
Yeah.
Now, the human-canine bond has been developing all in the same direction for tens of millennia. I don't think any decision made by an institution like sheltering is going to reverse or endanger that bond. But in the short term, it could do some harm to particular people and particular dogs.
Precisely. So, yeah, it's baffling. It's again, we just keep. Do we have any more questions that we haven't answered yet, Nick? I want to make sure everybody knows they're appreciated and that we're paying attention.
We have a really good concern that someone brings up that says, what concerns me is that PetSmart Charities making bold claims about the human half of the human-animal bond. Do they employ any experts on the issues affecting humans or human behavior in general? Seems like PetSmart Charities and the animal welfare field in general need to engage experts and can speak on these matters instead of basing conclusions on anecdotes and opinions. We theoretically require dog behavior experts to have advanced degrees and rigorous training. So why are so many in this field content with letting anyone with a hunch making claims about such important matters as poverty, public health, and social services?
That is a fantastic point.
Thank you, Kim.
That is a very, very good point. Did we talk about the claim about hoarding in this Facebook Live? That
no, we
talked
about.
Okay, so let's touch on that. Kim, thank you for prompting that. One of the claims that, and this is common, argument against the shelter ideology of no kill, and I think I don't think I've said this yet either. We don't think that animals in shelters should be killed for convenience or because of what they look like. We don't use the term no kill to describe how we operate our shelter, and we don't really have an opinion about how shelters self-identify. We just don't think you should be killing animals that are placeable. Right? Is that fair?
That is fair.
Okay, back to this. And one of the really common ways to argue against no kill is that it will lead to hoarding. But as Kim makes the point, hoarding is actually a mental illness.
Correct.
Right? It's only diagnosable by somebody who has training. Yet in the presentation that PetSmart Charities is putting forward, I mean, they make a lot of sweeping claims about pet owners and the communities they live in and the services we need to provide them without having the experience or the expertise to make those claims. Small rescues not knowing what they're doing. There's a lot of generalizations that we're not okay with. But Janice and I were talking about how they describe the hoarding as a danger. And it's troubling that they would make that prediction because just as this person says, there's no experience, as far as I'm concerned. And I've looked at their roster of employees. I've looked now at their board of directors trying to understand where they're getting this expertise from, and I can't find it. So, Janice, you happen to be close colleagues with someone who could arguably be the national leading expert on hoarding.
Yes, a colleague of mine, and I asked him about this. I mean, I really kind of knew the answer, but he said there's no practical way to measure the incidence of hoarding, and to be able to say that it's increasing, but it's irrelevant. It's a mental illness. It's a diagnosis in the DSM. It has nothing to do with a supposed proliferation of rescue organizations or no-kill. Animal professionals get involved in hoarding cases because when someone is found, you know, who's expressing this illness, there are animals in the picture. And so, you know, the animal professionals come in to deal with the animals, but that has nothing to do with the human behavior involved in hoarding.
So
animal welfare people should never be expected to have any expertise about that particular human pathology.
Right. So I think maybe it's safe to say that animal rescue does not cause hoarding.
I think so.
It's very safe to say that.
Okay, good. I'm glad we cleared that up. But I think too that can you do you have the Pets for Life data slide that you used? And so bear in mind that we're showing you this slide because of the context that it was used in, and a concern that was raised by PetSmart Charities that we certainly don't share the concern with. We have zero idea of how reliable any of this data is. We have no idea how reliable any of this data is because we have had no access to any bibliography. So don't assume that the data contained on this slide is accurate. We don't know.
Correct.
But what was interesting was the discussion about this slide. You noticed it.
So on the one side, it says that those folks in those neighborhoods, 85% of them have never had a dealing with a shelter or an animal control officer. He thought that that was a bad thing, because if animal control doesn't see them, then they don't see us. And I thought, well, that's great. 85% of the people that they did research on didn't have a need, didn't do anything that animal control needed to come to their home for, and they didn't surrender their animal to animal control. So I didn't quite understand why that was a bad thing.
Right, and you make a really, really excellent point. So it's because it's perspective, I think, is what it is. When you look at this as if the people in those as an issue, and then you're alarmed that 85% of those people have never been in contact with animal control or their shelter, and you think that's a bad thing, I think that's the wrong perspective. Shouldn't we be thankful that they're taking care of their pets? Because if they're not ending up in the shelter with animal control or a citation, that means there's no problem.
Right.
Right?
That's the way I read it.
But we have a different perspective than PetSmart Charities does, clearly. Right?
Yeah.
So. All right. So we're at an hour now, right? That's a pretty good amount of time. We could go on and on about this. We probably will go on and on about this in other mediums or maybe another Facebook Live if we get there. Again, we're not done talking about this until we actually understand this, because from our perspective, we will not go back to a day where it is acceptable to kill shelter dogs because of what they look like, or because they are inconvenient, because we think nobody wants them. Because I guarantee you that's your own problem, not the adopter's problem, because the adopters want the dogs. It makes me think perhaps we should do a little drive of people who have intentionally gone to shelters and adopted a dog with a label pit bull or a chihuahua. That would be interesting. That would be fun. It would get us lots of great pictures. So, anyway.
Pollyanna about this, but I think it's useful to remember that if there's a bright spot in all this, that it can be a reminder to all of us to be careful, critical consumers of information.
Absolutely.
And regardless of what organization is behind whatever you're listening to, that you're well advised not to take things at face value and really ask questions about, you know, where did that information come from? How reliable is it? What sort of action should I take based on this? It's a reminder.
Precisely.
Yep.
Precisely. And it, you know, it's the shelters that and organizations that have hosted this presentation makes me think we should really drive that message home to people in our field is be really careful consumers of the information that you're assuming is true or that you're promoting as true. Check sources, check sources, check sources. Ask for verification. Bernice, any parting words? No? Good, yeah.
Nothing.
We're all really tired with this. We've been working on this because, you know what, we're having some fun with it right now, but this has been really consuming for us because it's very serious. And when you unpack it and really look at this and you understand the politics of big org animal welfare, this presentation that PetSmart Charities is promoting right now is insidious. I don't really know any other way to describe it. It's insidious. It is a veiled attack on shelter ideology of no kill, and the opposite of no kill is yes kill. So do we think that unsafe dogs, before anybody gets worried, but do we think unsafe dogs need to be adopted out? No, the answer is no. If a dog is unsafe, the dog doesn't get adopted out, but that's not what no kill is. No kill means you work your tail off and you get creative to find a place for the animals in your care that can go home. And it's really unacceptable that an organization as large as PetSmart Charities is promoting anything except that.
Mm-hmm.
Dogs are not a danger to us. They have not been shelter animals. The quality of shelter animals is not on the decline. It's a dangerous message and an incorrect message to be putting forth. If your mission is to help shelters and people and animals, why on earth would you try to villainize a group of animals at the shelter? It's beyond us. So, any questions left that we didn't answer yet? Anybody that we need to respond to before we sign off here?
Nope. I just want to go back to being a smart consumer, though, real quick. And if you're putting on these conferences as well, make sure that you're paying attention to who you're having come speak to your communities.
Right. Yeah. No, I see one of the big upcoming national conference next month has somebody that's doing a presentation on the pit bull problem and what are we going to do about the pit bull problem. It's like, well, stop labeling all your dogs pit bull, regardless of what they are, and then you don't have a problem anymore. But alas, I mean, Amy, they have to be given a platform for somebody to give a presentation. So those of you organizing conferences, let's get a little bit smarter about the information we're putting forward. With that. And so should we tell everybody what we're doing while that national conference is going on?
Sure.
And give everybody a little hint. So there's the national conference, Pet Expo or Animal Care Expo is going on next month in New Orleans. And instead of going to the conference, we're going to South Carolina and we're going to meet with pet owners. And the reason we're doing this is another pretty well-known animal welfare organization, Charleston Animal Society, or I think it's Charleston Animal Society, and its leader, Joe Elmore, are supporting breed-specific mandatory spay-neuter that is not funded, but they're promoting it. And so what they're really going to do is just end up criminalizing pet owners. And again, just like with PetSmart Charities, we seem to be the only ones speaking out against it. So instead of going to the conference where we can talk about the pit bull problem or whatever it is they're going to talk about, we're going to go to South Carolina and we're going to meet pet owners and talk to them about the challenges they face. So hope you join us on that ride too. Thank you guys very much, everybody, for participating, for listening. The conversation's not over. We're going to keep going until we figure out what's happening. I hope you participate and help us along the way. And again, be careful consumers of information before you share it. Check your sources before you promote it. Check your sources. Verify it. All right, everybody. Thank you.
Have a great night.
Good night.